Tonight's beer is a completely different style than I usually have, but for the novelty of it, why not? This is from Wayne Gretzky Craft Brewing number 99 Rye Lager. They call it a smooth malt and light hops with brewed with rye grain instead of the usual barley. Interesting. So today, I thought I would do a bit of a teardown on these devices here. What I've got here is an assortment of things from a security system that we no longer use at work. This is some stuff from the Super Track Key system. I tore down one of these keys, the predecessor to this version, some time ago, and I'll put a link up there in the corner. So I'm not going to tear down this key. This one's a little bit different than that one. It has a little display on it, and it's got a non-replaceable battery inside of it. So little infrared window up there and a couple of contacts for it to power this type of device through those two contacts up there. So under normal circumstances, you'd punch in your code, plug it in, it would power this lockbox device. And this would just be on a on an armored vault with keys in it on the outside of a building somewhere. Anyway, so you'd punch in your secret code, put it in there, they'd handshake and negotiate back and forth. The light would flash, you'd hear a little click, which would be a solenoid inside there releasing, and then you'd operate the lever, and if the solenoid had engaged that lever, it would retract these two metal locking bars here. They tell me they are solid steel and a very high quality steel. And actually, in the documentation, it talks about the whole thing being made out of some very solid steel. This front faceplate being almost a centimeter thick of steel. And so is the box that it goes into. So, I mean, with an angle grinder and enough time, you could probably get through anything, right? But it's going to slow you down and force you to make enough noise that you're going to get noticed if you're trying to break into one of these things. Like any security device, it's only there to slow you down enough to make it not worth your effort. So that's the older version of the lockbox type. This is the one that replaced it, which, as you can see, is Bluetooth, and there's no place to put the key in. So it's got a battery inside it. Again, non-replaceable, so when that battery expires, you send this back to the company and they sell you a new one, I guess. Anyway, they are upgrading their system, Supra, the manufacturer, to deprecate these ones, and I think also deprecate those and these keys and go to a newer system. So the company that I work with said, you know what, if you're forcing us to change your system anyway, we're going to change it to a different vendor. So that's how come all this stuff ended up in the trash and I grabbed it before it got thrown away. So that's the two that are the sort of lockbox or key box or key vault. So I'm going to tear into one of those two. Then the other part of the system, just for doorknobs and door locks, it has basically the front part of this on the outside of the door, so you can put your key into the cradle, or the front part of this one, the Bluetooth that negotiates with the key. So those two are, like I said, the outside of the door would have just the front part of that on it, and then inside the door there would be one of these boxes that's got some control electronics in it, and then the door latch would have a solenoid latch or an electronic latch, like so many other electronic latches that you've probably seen on businesses and whatnot. So I'm just going to quickly pop the lid off this guy. Whoever put the lid back on this one really put it on. They obviously used a drill and they countersunk those screws straight in there. Okay, anyway, that's off. Inside, we have some electronics. We have a little battery holder here and some screw terminals to the outside world. Yeah, so there's input power, DC output. So the input power can come from an external wall wart or something. DC output, that goes to the little solenoid release on the door. And there's some other connections that I'm actually not sure what they are. I don't know that we ever used them when these were in service. And then a set of dip switches to program it for various different settings. I think you can program the input voltage coming from your external power supply. This battery, I think you can just see it there. It's a 12 volt battery, plugs onto there. There, that little 4-pin goes to a cable that goes out through the hole and to the faceplate on the door, either like I said, one of those or one of those that the key negotiates with. Then what do we have in here? We have a relay. We have a bunch of stuff underneath a heat sink up there. Some big honking diodes. The brains of the operation, no doubt, with some secrets hidden inside it. Let me pull this board out and see if we can see any further underneath there. Not exactly sure what I'm expecting to find under here, to be honest. Ah, there's some of those, remember in mailbag a while back, I got some threaded inserts to go into plastic? That's essentially what those guys are there. Anyway, so underneath the heat sink, there's not as much going on as I would have thought. There's a couple of good-sized capacitors. There is what looks like an inductor. And then there's a chip hiding underneath it. In a white body. That's a little unexpected. Ah, there's what the heat sink's for. LT1170HV. I'm guessing that's power supply device, probably. There's some sizable diodes down below it there. Yeah, so that's clearly quite power supply-ish. That capacitor is 220 micro at 63 volts. Can't see what that one is in there. That is some kind of international rectifier device. IRF9Z34. Is that a MOSFET? I think that's a MOSFET part number, if I'm not mistaken. Which means that is probably what's driving this relay, I would guess. And then there's the magic underneath here. That's a little PIC microcontroller. Okay. So we have no idea what's going on inside there, other than it's got the code, no doubt. Although U3 might be a little prom for it. Can't read the number under the conformal coding, unfortunately. So not a huge amount going on that board. Fairly low component count, actually. I mean, there's the usual little passives and stuff down there, but yeah, that's kind of neat. So I would expect inside this guy there is something very similar going on. It's a PIC microcontroller. But in there, it'll have the lithium-ion battery. I think it mentioned it on the back of here. Yeah, it did. Lithium-ion, 2 cells, 3 volts. Well, I guess, tear into that unit. Those screws are a really oddball hex size that I couldn't find in my collection. But that Torx bit jammed in there fits, mostly. So what happens here? Is that the battery on the back? Interesting. It's all potted. There's a bunch of wires going into it and capacitor. I don't know. I'll have to peel that potting compound off there. Anyway, there's 2 wires going from that to this little solenoid here. And the little solenoid is what engages with the lever on the front and allows those little locking lugs to be pulled back. So that's not much of a movement, but it's just enough to allow it to catch. Interesting. Because there is a battery in here, I'm gonna cut these wires one at a time. I'm not sure where my good cutters are, so I'm having to use these crap ones. I'm gonna guess that the black and red wires are the battery. I suppose I could check that. Nope. Maybe the battery's in there then. So let's pull that solenoid out first. Magnetic sensor systems. So there's the little solenoid. I got a little over 12 volts on the power supply. Don't have to be too precise on this. Then there we go. Just snaps in like that fairly decisively. About 360 or so milliamps. Under normal operation, that guy's only pulled in for like 15 or 20 seconds. Just long enough to do that. Let us look a little bit deeper into this thing. See what we can find. That's just a mechanical back plate. Slides out. There's the locking lugs. I'm not going to give you too much detail about what's going on in the mechanical parts. Even though my company's not using these anymore, presumably somebody is. I don't want to get hunted down by the company. A couple of springs, another little lever, a little pivot. Okay, so that's all the mechanical side of it. So if you, you know, smash into the electronic side here, you're not going to be able to control that solenoid because it's controlled by whatever's back in here on the secure side. So these four wires, I'm assuming two of them are power, and the other ones will be some kind of, you know, data communications, probably to this thing. So you're fairly secure even if you abuse the front of this thing. It's not a bad design. So you can find some screws underneath here. Oh yeah, there's some buried deep down in there. Okay, there we go. And yeah, so there is the thickness of metal that if you were going to, you know, aggressively attack this thing, you'd have to get through. And I know for a fact that this is really hard stuff. I've tried to drill through one time at work just to get into it, and it was a real pain in the ass. We actually dulled completely two carbide bits trying to get through that. So I mean, you can do it, but it ain't easy. And there's what's on the back of the front bit. I'm guessing that is our battery there. All that's left now is to try and pick out this coating, this potting compound. And it is that usual kind of potting compound, that just kind of silicone rubbery, kind of crusty. It comes out, but you got to work at it. So this is my life now for the next little while. Ah, I found a circuit board already. So it occurred to me partway through this process that digging around in here with a charged battery using metal tools might not be the smartest thing in the world. And yeah, I've exposed the battery terminals there on the circuit board. So let's just see. Do it carefully here. 3.12 volts. And it said on the outside of the case, I think, 3-volt lithium ion. Yeah, it says so right there. Okay. So that's no doubt what that is. I think I've got enough taken apart now that I can pull the circuit board off. And that's one of the screws that both holds the battery down, but also I think holds the circuit board in. Let's see what happens. Hey, there's that. That's definitely a battery, or cell if you prefer. Oh, the shape of that looks like it's two batteries in series. Interesting. So you can get into them without exploding them. There it comes. Varta micro battery, 2 CR, 2/3 amp hour, 3-volt lithium. Symbol in Indonesia, do not garbage. I think I'm going to chop those wires off so that that thing is not going to put me at too much of a risk. And then I can pry with impunity under this circuit board. There we go. Let's get the rest of this snot off here and I'll be right back. All right, so here it is. So we got the push button on the front panel here, which I think I'm going to salvage. Got this little piece on here that pops off. Now that's the lens where the LED was shining through the front here. So what we have in here, it looks like there's two LEDs there and there, which are probably visible light LEDs. And then there's this little package here, which I originally thought was just some infrared LEDs or something, but no, it's labeled U2 and it's got a bunch of pins on it. So that is probably transmitting and receiving to talk to that little infrared window on the key. So that's how it handshakes back and forth with the key. Okay. And then a bunch of passives and stuff. Got Y1 over there, which is going to be a resonator or a crystal or something. A couple of smaller chips down there. And then the main event, which is no doubt going to be a microcontroller of some kind. Texas Instruments 86AX430F533. And then a little Atmel chip there, which is probably got the serial number for the device in it, if I had to guess. And a few other little components down here. What's this? No idea. It's got a lot of pins on it, though. Must be doing some kind of thinking. So there's the four wires that go to that other board. Ground VBAT2, SDA and SCL. So that is communicating with this guy using I2C. no doubt it's got a fairly complex protocol, though, to talk to it. It's going to be encrypted of some sort, I would guess. It wouldn't be so easy as to just get in there, listen to the I2C with a valid key, and then duplicate that. Of course, if you're doing that, that means you've got a valid key, and why would you be breaking in? I guess this is the only mystery that's left. And now that I know that there's not a battery in there. There we go. So what's in here? So we have one brain box, some transistors, an inductor. Oh, hey, that's going to be a little power supply by the looks of it. To boost the voltage. Yeah, of course it is. Because that little solenoid guy, it took a little over 12 volts to make him click. And this thing is obviously 3 volts. Which means that we do have a little boost converter in there, no doubt. So this little TI chip will be the one that's talking I2C to the main board. I don't recognize that part number. Probably just a little microcontroller of some sort. And then we've got a little boost converter. Relatively heavy transistor. One of those two is going to be sending the output to the solenoid. Yeah, that one right there is going to be driving the solenoid. And again, it took, what did I say, a third of an amp or thereabouts to drive it at about 12 volts. So that's most of what's going to be going on in here. Which is similar, you know, to what we found going on in here as well, right? Not exactly the same, but similar enough. Which makes sense because the same guys designed it. Oh, that was fun. And messy and destructive and entertaining and somewhat informative. I mean, I'm not really surprised what I found in there. I was kind of expecting microcontrollers and a few other things, but it's good to know. Anyways, thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below. I'll talk to you later.